Counterpoint, the general knowledge music quiz, chaired by Paul Gambaccini.
Hello, we are back at the College of Musical Knowledge as we begin the quest for the 33rd Counterpoint Champion. Over the next 3 months, we'll meet amateur music lovers from around the UK. After all the knockout stages, one of them will lift the trophy as the musical mastermind of the year. Could it be one of today's trio of contenders who's destined to go all the way? Let's meet them.
Hi, I'm Alexandra Denman, and I'm a copywriter from Bristol.
Hello, I'm Neil Morgan. I'm an airline pilot from Hampshire.
Hello, I'm RUFUS STILGOE, an amateur writer from South London.
You are all welcome. The opening round tests your musical general knowledge, and among your questions will be musical extracts to identify. By convention, we ask the questions in this round in rotation, following alphabetical surname order. That means the first question of the 2019 Counterpoint season is for you, Alex Denman. According to the title of a best-selling book by the writer and orchestral oboist Blair Tyndall, subsequently dramatized on television, which composer is in the jungle?
I have no idea.
Neil Morgan?
When in doubt, say Mozart.
He's right! And Neil Morgan, here is your own question. For the first musical extract of this series, you're about to hear a track which in 2006 provided the last ever studio performance on a normal edition of Top of the Pops. Can you name the song and the band?
If I lay here, if I just lay here, would you lie away? Forget what we're told before we get too old. Show me a garden that's bursting into life.
That's Chasing Cars by Snow Patrol.
That's right, for 2 points. RUFUS STILGOE, the conductors Andrus Nelsons, Daniel Harding, and Gerard Schwartz, who between them have held major posts with orchestras in Liverpool, Paris, Boston, and Leipzig, are all also players of orchestral standard on which instrument?
Fanon?
No. Anyone else want to light it up? Neil Morgan?
Cello?
No, not the cello.
Oboe?
No. The trumpet was the correct answer. Back to you, Alex Denman. And we turn to opera for your first musical extract. Which 1862 opera premiered in St. Petersburg and recently revived in London begins with these portentous brass notes?
Force of Destiny?
That's right, by Verdi, La Forza del Destino. Neil Morgan, the jazz group, the Quintet du Hot Club de France, was co-founded in 1934 by guitarist Django Reinhardt and which French musician often said to be the grandfather of jazz violinists?
Stefan Grappelli.
That's right. RUFUS STILGOE, you're going to hear music from a live recording by David Gilmour of his 2007 performance at the Royal Albert Hall. Listen and a question will follow. That concert was also released as a DVD entitled Remember That Night. Not including any of the main band members, do you remember any two of the special guests on stage with David Gilmour that night?
No.
Well, you're an honest man, Rufus. Anyone else want to take a guess? It's obvious there isn't anybody on stage who has the DVD Remember That Night. Otherwise, they would have seen in action David Bowie, Robert Wyatt, David Crosby, and Graham Nash. And Crosby and Nash were heard on Wish You Were Here, which we just played. Alex Denman. A Symphony in Blue and Yellow is a book which came out in 2018 examining the link between the musical world and a famous 19th century painter. Which painter?
Whistler?
Oh. No, I'm sorry, it wasn't. And Rufus Stilgoe suggests?
Van Gogh.
That's right, it was Vincent van Gogh, A Symphony in Blue and Yellow. Neil Morgan, the British composer Carl Jenkins' 2011 work, The Peacemakers, is dedicated to the memory of people who lost their lives during various conflicts, in particular innocent civilians. In this elegy, he pays tribute to which 20th century activist and advocate of nonviolence?
Gandhi?
I'm sorry, it wasn't Gandhi. The clue is if you could discern the lyrics. Anyone else paying attention to the words? It was Martin Luther King. We heard he had a dream. Mm-hmm. Rufus Stilgoe. A hitherto unknown work by an earlier British composer was recently found in an autograph book and sold at an auction in Lichfield in 2019. The book belonged to Lydia Tabb, a former Bernardo's matron who did her autograph hunting in the first half of the 20th century. Who was that English composer who wrote a tune for her?
Purcell?
No, it wasn't, Neil Morgan says.
Britain?
No, it wasn't Britain. And Alex says?
Holst?
No. All nice guesses, but it was Elgar. Unfortunately, the piece is only 6 bars long, but as they'd say on the Antiques Roadshow, it's a nice thing to have. Alex Denman, I'd like you to listen to this extract from a musical that recently enjoyed a critically acclaimed Broadway and West End revival. Which musical is this from?
Whenever I feel afraid, I hold my head erect and whistle a happy tune so no one will suspect I'm afraid. While shivering in my shoes, I strike a careless pose and whistle a happy tune and no one ever knows I'm afraid.
That's The King and I.
That's right. We heard I Whistle a Happy Tune, sung by Anna, played by Deborah Carr, but famously dubbed by Marnie Nixon. Neil Morgan, the song The Greatest Love of All, written by Michael Masser with lyrics by Linda Creed, was a major international hit for Whitney Houston in 1985, but the original from 8 years earlier by George Benson was used as the main theme for a movie telling the story of which celebrated figure from the world of sport?
Muhammad Ali.
That's right. The movie was called The Greatest, hence the song The Greatest Love of All. And the person who played Ali was Ali. Finally, in this round, Rufus Stilgoe. Here's an arrangement for cello of an operatic aria, which Pablo Casals liked to play as an encore. Sorry, it isn't Lohengrin. Alex says...
Tannhäuser?
That's right, it was Tannhäuser by Wagner. We heard To the Evening Star, played by Alban Gerhardt. And so, at the end of the opening round, in third place with 1 point is RUFUS STILGOE. Lying second with 5 points is Alex DENMAN. And in the lead with 7 points is Neil Morgan. Those scores have a bearing on what happens next, because I'm about to give our competitors their choice of special subjects for the second round. There are 5 categories to pick from. They will pick in the order of their scores so far. They have no idea what I'm about to offer them and have had no chance to prepare. So, here are today's categories. Composers who died young. Oscar-winning musicals. Feline groovy. Bach to the future. Kate Bush. Neil Morgan, you're in the lead at the moment. What would you like?
I'd like to take Feline Groovy, please.
And Alex, what's your choice?
I'll try Oscar-winning musicals.
And that leaves 3 for RUFUS STILGOE. Composers who died young, Bach to the future, and Kate Bush.
I'll try composers who died young.
This is an individual round, and we don't offer you bonus points for other people's questions. Let's start with RUFUS STILGOE and... composers who died young. The composer who was a torchbearer at Beethoven's funeral died a year later. Who was he?
Schubert.
That's right, it was Schubert. He was only 31 at the time of his death, and he was buried a few yards from Beethoven in a graveyard on the outskirts of Vienna. Both graves have since been moved and are in the city's central cemetery. When I was in Vienna a couple of years ago, it was suggested to me at breakfast that I take a breakfast roll and take it out to the cemetery and hold it over the grave of Beethoven. It would be posted on social media with the caption, "Roll over Beethoven." I decided not to do so. This music, originally written for the funeral of an English queen, was used at the composer's own funeral. Composer and the title of the music, please.
Well, I'm guessing it's Purcell and Funeral March for Queen Anne.
You named Purcell earlier in this program. I'm glad to say that this time he's the right answer. So you get a point. But it is the funeral music for Queen Mary. George Butterworth's career was cut short after he was killed in action during the First World War. The English composer's popular orchestral rhapsody, A Shropshire Lad, was partly inspired by a book of poems by which writer?
A.E. Housman.
That is correct for 2 points. Here's some music from an opera by a composer who died tragically from a brain tumor at the age of 38. Which composer and which opera?
Oh, I got plenty of nothing, and nothing's plenty for me. I got no car, I got no mule, I got no misery. The folks with plenty of plenty got a lock on their door. Afraid somebody's going to rob him while he's out to make it more. What for?
That's Gershwin, Porgy and Bess.
That's right. And we heard Willard White, I Got Plenty of Nuttin'. Staying with opera, it's thought that Mozart actually completed another opera after The Magic Flute, even though The Magic Flute was the last to be premiered. The opera in question is set in ancient Rome. What is its title?
The Clemenza di Titus?
That's right, La Clemenza di Tito. From opera to cantata, the composer of this aria was barely into his 20s when he wrote it towards the end of the Victorian era. Please name the cantata and its talented but sadly short-lived composer.
Wild bird of the prairie. soft and fawn-like.
Is it Coleridge Taylor?
That's right. And can you name the work?
No. Oh, Hiawatha, but...
Okay, Hiawatha's good enough. It's Hiawatha's Wedding Feast. You get a point for that, and you get a point for Coleridge Taylor. Finally, in this round on composers who died young, the works Faust et Hélène and Du Fond de l'Abîme were composed by the first woman to win the French scholarship Prix de Rome. Who was she?
Lily Boulanger.
That's right, Lily Boulanger, who died in 1918 in her mid-20s. And so, Rufus Stilgoe, in that round you scored 13 points added to your previous one. You now have 14 points. Alex Denman, here are your questions on Oscar-winning musicals. The 1937 film A Star is Born has been remade several times, most recently in 2018 with Bradley Cooper taking the part of a fading star. Who was the singer who played the up-and-coming female star in that film?
Lady Gaga.
That's right. And Shallow from that film won the Oscar for Best Original Song. Here's another recent Oscar winner. Please name the film.
La La Land?
That's right, that was from La La Land. As the world well knows, La La Land missed out on the Oscar for Best Picture, but didn't win the Oscar for Best Original Score and that for Best Original Song, among other categories. Two Hollywood musicals of the 1950s were set in Paris and went on to win the Oscar for Best Picture. Please name them both. You'll get a point for each one.
Gigi?
Yes.
An American in Paris?
That's right. They were both directed by Vincente Minnelli, who himself won an Oscar for Gigi. Chicago won the Oscar for Best Picture in 2003. This American artist played the plum role of the corrupt prison matron, Mama Morton. Who is she?
Ask any of the chickies in my pen. They'll tell you I'm the biggest mother hen.
That's Queen Latifah.
That's right, it was Queen Latifah. Which 1936 Hollywood musical, a major commercial and critical success at the time, starred William Powell in the title role of a legendary Broadway producer?
Ziegfeld Follies?
Great
Ziegfeld.
The Great Ziegfeld is the correct answer, and we'll give you the full 2 points. Florence Ziegfeld made an appearance in this 1968 Hollywood musical in which he was played by Walter Pidgeon. Which singer performs the leading female role now? I'd also like you to name the movie.
Don't tell me not to live, just sit and putter. Life's candy and the sun's a ball of butter. Don't bring around a cloud to rain on my parade. Don't tell me not to fly, I simply got to. If someone takes a spill, it's me and not you. Who told you you're allowed to rain on my parade?
Barbra Streisand in Funny Girl.
That's right. Barbra Streisand shared the Oscar for Best Actress, an event not seen before or since, with Katharine Hepburn for The Lion in Winter. Your last question on Oscar-winning musicals. Funny Girl, though nominated for Best Picture, lost out in that category to a film with an essentially British pedigree. Which musical was that?
Oliver?
It was Oliver for 2 points. The guess is good, and Alex Denman, you have achieved a perfect round. Your 14 points added to your previous 5 give you a total of 19 points. Neil Morgan, I hope you really are feline groovy. Walt Disney's 1970 jazz-inspired animation, The Aristocats, tells the tale of a wealthy socialite who plans to leave her entire fortune to her beloved cat, Duchess, and Duchess's three kittens. Two of the kittens are named Marie and Toulouse, whilst the third is named after which 19th century composer?
I don't know.
It was Berlioz. Your first piece of music evokes another cartoon cat, Garfield, as voiced by Bill Murray in animated feature films. The second of these, in 2006, features Garfield reenacting the Marx Brothers' famous mirror scene from Duck Soup. It's accompanied by this pizzicato. After you've heard it, I'd like you to name the ballet it's originally from, along with the composer.
Swan Lake, Tchaikovsky?
Oh, I'm sorry, it's Sylvia by Delibes. In the early 1980s, the American rockabilly trio The Stray Cats had three top 20 hits in the UK. Can you name any two of them for your 2 points?
Stray Cat Strut?
Yes.
Rockabilly Rebel?
No, it would either be Rock This Town or Runaway Boys. More music. You're about to hear an extract from Cats, the musical by Andrew Lloyd Webber, based, of course, on poems by T.S. Eliot. Can you tell me the name of the particular cat that is the subject of this song?
He is quiet and small. He is black from his ears to the tip of his tail. He can creep through the tiniest crack. He can walk on the narrowest rail. He can pick any card from a pack. He is equally cunning with dice. He is always deceiving you into believing that he's only hunting for mice.
Drawing a blank here, McCavity.
Oh no, it was Mr. Mistopheles. We heard Paul Nicholas with the magical Mr. Mistopheles. Which artist wrote and recorded the song that begins, I gave my woman half my money at the general store. I said, now buy a little groceries and don't spend no more. But she paid $10 for a 10-cent hat and got some store-bought cat food for a mean-eyed cat.
Haven't got a clue.
Okay, we could play cat and mouse, but I'll just say it was Johnny Cash. The following extract is from the song Cat People, Putting Out Fire, as featured in Paul Schrader's 1982 cult horror film, Cat People, starring Natasha Kinski. It's sung by David Bowie, but can you tell me the name of its award-winning producer?
Quincy Jones?
Oh, I'm sorry. The producer of that was Giorgio Moroder. Finally, in 2005, the American girl group The Pussycat Dolls had a UK number one with Don'tcha. Which New York-born rapper also features in this version of the song?
Nicki Minaj?
I'm afraid it was Busta Rhymes. And don't you wish you'd chosen another round?
I certainly do. I certainly do.
Feeling Groovy proved to be a dog of a round for Neil Morgan. Your 1 point added to 7 means you now have 8 points. Let's recap on how the scores now stand. In third place with 8 points is Neil Morgan. Lying second with 14 points, it's Rufus Stilgoe. And our leader with just 1 round to go with 19 points is Alexandra Denman. It's all on the buzzer in the quick fire. Final round. Things can change quickly, except, of course, it's not a buzzer. It's actually a light. A correct answer wins you 1 point, but you lose a point if you light up and fail to answer correctly. There are no bonuses. So, fingers poised. Here we go. The title of which Mozart opera roughly translates into English as All Women Do the Same, and Alex says?
Così fan tutte.
For the point. Fred Graham and Lily Vanessi are characters in, and Alex says?
Kiss Me, Kate.
And she's right. Who is the leader of the rock band Muse? And Alex says...
Is that Guy Garvey?
No, it's not Guy Garvey. Minus one, it's Matt Bellamy. The marimba is found in which section of the orchestra? Rufus Stilgoe?
Percussion.
That's right. The Blumine movement is generally nowadays cut from which Mahler Symphony, Rufus Stilgoe?
One.
That's right. Which hymn is the anthem of the Women's Institute? Rufus.
Jerusalem.
That's right. According to the title of their second number one hit, which day of the week do the Boomtown Rats dislike, Rufus?
Mondays.
He's on a roll. Who founded the Monteverdi Choir in 1964? And Rufus says?
John Elliott Gardner.
And he's right. Which Roman emperor gets a mention in the Smith song, Heaven Knows I'm Miserable Now? Neil Morgan.
Caligula.
He's correct. Which British composer wrote many of his compositions while teaching at St. Paul's Girls' School? And Rufus says?
Gustav Holst.
That's right. Which word connects a 1984 hit song by Queen with Stephanie Joanne Angelina Germanotta? Alex.
Gaga.
That is right. The song's Radio Gaga, and she's Lady Gaga. And I thought I got a point for saying her name right. Ralph Vaughan Williams' Seventh Symphony is named after which continent? And Alex says?
Antarctica.
For the point. Which radio station, founded in 1964 by Ronan O'Reilly, was named after the daughter of President John F. Kennedy? Neil Morgan.
Caroline.
That's right, Radio Caroline. Which song, first released 50 years ago, begins with the lines, Ever since I was a young boy, and Neil says?
Pinball Wizard.
Right. Which is the only opera in Wagner's Ring Cycle to feature a chorus? Alex.
Valkyrie.
Oh, no. Minus one. It's Götterdämmerung. The female sheep, who became the first mammal cloned from an adult somatic cell, was named after which musician, Neil Morgan?
Dolly Parton.
You know your sheep. New York, London, Paris, Munich. Everybody's talking about what? Neil Morgan.
Pop music.
You know your pop music. And finally, in the Sam Cooke song, Wonderful World, can you name two of the subjects he didn't know much about? Alex.
History and biology?
That's correct. At the end of this first heat of Counterpoint 2019, the final scores are third with 13 points, Neil Morgan, runner-up with 20 points is Rufus Stilgoe, and our winner with 22 points is Alexandra Denman. Well done, Alexandra Denman. It means you'll be back for the semifinals in November, and well done for the other two for giving us such a close and entertaining contest. Another three music lovers will be playing Counterpoint next week. I hope you'll make a point of joining us. Meanwhile, remember, you can always see a full list of the music played in today's program on our pages on the Radio 4 website. And you can take this program away as a podcast from BBC Sounds. Until next time, goodbye.